So you have studied exergy. Sorry, you have studied entropy. Now we'll a similar concept is called exergy. So that we'll explore what it is and how to use it for our practical examples. So your syllabus talks about exergy and dead state, reversible work and irreversibility, second law efficiency. So till now we have looked into first law efficiency. Now we'll also define efficiency based on the second law, and we'll also talk about how to do exergy analysis for a closed and open system, and finally we'll end with the Gauss-Rudolph theorem. Okay, so let us begin with some simple examples. So let us say that you have a block of metal or any material which is at 100 degrees Celsius, right, and your ambient air is at room temperature, like 30 degrees Celsius. So can I extract any work from this block, metal block? How can I do that? If I want to use this heat and do some work, so what is I need for that?
Heat transfer, sir.
Heat transfer or heat engine? Heat transfer,
heat engine.
Yes. So what I can do is I can use a heat engine. I will say that this is my high temperature reservoir at 100 degrees Celsius, low temperature reservoir, which is the ambient atmosphere. It is at 30 degrees Celsius, and using a heat engine, I am extracting some work. Now, this is not an infinite reservoir, right? So after some time, the temperature will come down. So let us say at some point, this also comes to 30 degrees Celsius. Now your atmosphere is also at 30 degrees Celsius. So can I extract any work from this now? No, right?
No, sir.
At the same temperature, then the cycle will not run. I cannot get any work output, so work will be zero. Okay. So is that mean that there is no energy left in this block at 30 degrees Celsius? Can I say so?
No, sir.
Why?
Sir, because it still has temperature is not zero kelvins, so it still has some energy.
So what I can do, so if I want to extract more energy from it, so let us say I have a block at 30 degrees Celsius, and let us say my room temperature is much lower, let us say I go to some mountains or Kashmir, so I have ambient temperature of minus 20 degrees Celsius. So I can use that block. I can again put a heat engine, and I can use two temperature reservoirs and extract some work. So it will do some work. But after some time, it will again come to minus 20 degrees Celsius, and then work will be stopped. There will be no work, right? Now what we see from these examples is that the amount of useful work, okay, whatever work we can extract, that does not only depends on the system, but it also depends on the state of system and surrounding both. So it is not only the temperature of the block, the surrounding is also important. What is the temperature of the surrounding where you want to apply a heat engine, right? Now, maximum possible work can be obtained if the cycle is reversible. So basically you are trying to minimize losses. All the processes are reversible from initial to final conditions, and finally you are in thermal equilibrium with the surrounding, or in simple words you can say that your the temperature of the system is equal to the temperature of the surroundings. So this is what we saw, right? So this has become equal to minus 20, this has become equal to 30. So when the temperature of this source or high temperature reservoir becomes equal to the surrounding, then we cannot obtain work, and this is the maximum limit. So maximum work can be obtained if we run that engine till this point. Okay, so that is what is shown here, and this state is called dead state. So how do we define a dead state? So system is said to be in a dead state when it is under thermodynamic equilibrium with its environment. or as I said that the temperature of the system is the same as the temperature of the surrounding, then we say that it is a dead state. Now no more heat transfer can occur between the system and the surrounding, and you cannot use any heat engine. To give you a very simple example. Okay, now let us define exergy. So exergy is the useful work potential. Okay, useful. So this, let me underline this. This word is very important. Useful. Useful work potential for a given amount of energy. Okay. Energy at a specified state is called exergy. It is also referred as availability or available energy. Okay, so it is not the total energy. It is the available energy which you can use to do work, which you can use to do useful work. Okay, now it does not specify how much the device will work. It does not tells you what is the actual work done by the device. The actual work could be lower than that. Okay, so it says that exergy represents the upper limit. Okay, whatever is the maximum possible work using that device at that particular surrounding temperature, that is what is given by exergy. Okay, without which can be done without violating any laws. So theoretically, maximum possible work that a device can do, that is given by exergy. Whether that device is doing that much work or lower than that, that I don't care, but it cannot do more work than this. Okay, so the actual work produced would be less than or equal to exergy. It cannot exceed exergy. This is a theoretical maximum. So if it is, everything is perfectly fine, so you will achieve this. Otherwise, you will always, for real cases, you will be lower, the useful work will be lower than this. Right? Okay, now how do I define exergy for some simple cases? So let us say you have a dam or you have some water head. So you have water at some height which has potential energy, m dot is the flow rate, m dot gh or gz. So exergy is x is the symbol used for energy, exergy. So exergy for potential energy for this system which is as stored potential energy, we define exergy as gz. So this is again per unit mass, because it is small symbol. If you like capital Z, then you also need to multiply by mass. Similarly, when your energy is in the form of potential kinetic energy, when you have velocity, so for example, what we use for wind turbine. Okay, so there exergy can be denoted as V square by 2. Okay, so this is basically the maximum energy that is available, right? So this is the total potential energy, mgz. This is the total kinetic energy, V square by 2. So this is the theoretical maximum possible work that can be obtained, right? If you have everything, if your system is perfect, you have all, all reversible processes, there are no frictional loss and all, then you might be able to achieve this. Otherwise, whatever the useful work produced is less than this. That's all. Okay, now one interesting point is that we have talked a lot about the piston cylinder arrangement, right? So when the system expands, okay, so it also has to push this atmospheric air. Atmospheric air is pushing the system with P naught. Now if you expand the system, if the piston goes up, then that air is also pushed out, right? So some work has to be spent to overcome this. Okay, there is no vacuum outside. Some gas is there at some pressure, basically atmospheric pressure, that you are pushing to move out, right? So that work is called surrounding work. How much work you are spending to push the piston just to overcome this air resistance. Okay, that is called surrounding work, and this is obviously a loss, right? So when you say useful work, I say work W useful is equal to what is the total work done by the system minus what is the work which got wasted. Okay, work done on the surrounding is basically we are wasting energy or work, so that has to be subtracted. So your useful would be difference of total work minus what is done to the surrounding. Now, for cyclic devices or steady flow devices, okay, so for you have a, let us say, cyclic engine, or you have a turbine or compressor, things like that, or you are having a rigid tank. So inside that you have a stirrer. So if you remember, this is what we discussed in the first law, Joule's experiment. So if we have something like this, so there is no moving boundary. Okay, we don't have a piston cylinder which goes out. So for this scenarios, no work is done. Okay, no, there is no surrounding work. There could be other losses. There could be frictional losses or heat loss or things like that. But no work is done to push surrounding air or surrounding work. Is this clear? Yes. No.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us now talk about reversible work. So this is defined as the maximum amount of useful work that can be produced by the system as the system undergoes a process between specified initial and final states. So when you take the system from initial to final state, if you go using a reversible process, then that is the maximum work that is produced, okay, or the minimum work that needs to be supplied. So for example, when you are talking about heat pump or refrigerator, then you need some work input, right? So if it is reversible, you need minimum work. If it is not reversible, then you need more work than that. And the difference between reversible and useful work is due to irreversibility in the system. Basically, you are losing some amount of work or energy, and this difference is called irreversibility. Okay. Now this irreversibility corresponds to how much exergy you are destroying. So exergy is the capacity to do work. It is the maximum theoretical limit which you can do work without violating any thermodynamic laws. And this is you are not able to achieve the full your full potential in a real device. So why? Because all real devices have irreversibility. So the total work or useful work what you do using a real device will be the difference of whatever the total potential was there in that device minus how much heat you lost to irreversibility. So I can write I as W reversible. This is irreversibility is equal to reversible minus useful work. So if your engine or any device, if that is producing work, so this reversible work has to be more than useful work. Or in other terms, I can say that I is always greater than zero, greater than equal to zero. Okay, so it cannot be negative. You cannot take out work from irreversible process, but it will always result in loss of work. So that has to be more than equal to zero. Okay. So any questions still here, or should we move forward? People are quite silent today. I don't know what or why. So any doubt?
Why that W reversible is greater than or equals to W?
Okay. So W is W. Okay, let me go back to the last slide. So this is, let us say, this is W reversible. So because surrounding work is some greater than or equal to zero, right? It will be zero for this, but more than zero for this. It will not be negative. So this is, let me say, this is reversible. So if this is greater than or equal to zero, then this has to be greater than or equal to this or not. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
So that's what That is what is shown here. So that W is the second. This is for a general process. So it could be reversible, irreversible. But if I say that all my processes are ideal and reversible, so this is how I can write, and this is how I can, so that whatever maximum work we can do minus whatever useful we finally got, that difference is availability or irreversibility. Right. Okay. Okay. Moving on. Now let us say, let us take another interesting example. So let's say I have a heat pump. Okay. And we have two set of temperature sources. So basically the sink is, let us say the sink is at 500 Kelvin for both of them, and the source temperature is different. So for this is a heat engine A. So for A, T1 is 1000 Kelvin, and for B, T1 is 2000 Kelvin. Okay. Now let us say that these are actual or real engine which have irreversibility, or they are not, they are not producing 100% of what they can produce. So they have some losses, and let us say that the measured or actual reported efficiency is 40% for this and 50% for this. Fine. So which engine is better, A or B? Anyone? So we have two engines. One is giving 40% efficiency, one is giving 50%. Which one can I say that this is better or that one is better?
A, sir.
So first is better.
The A is better.
First is better. Why?
It is so because in this loss is very less.
So because it is.
Yes, one by one.
So in loss the first is engine, the loss is less.
Okay, let me take it forward. So you are on the right track. So actually it appears that this one is better, but the fact is that this one is better. Let me show you how. So if you calculate the first law efficiency, okay, 1 minus T1 by T2. So for A, it is coming to be 50%. And for B, using these temperatures, the efficiency is coming to be 75%. Okay. So this was supposed, ideally, if everything is perfectly, all the processes are reversible, it will give me 50% efficiency. But it is giving 40%, which is not very bad. But this is supposed to give 75%. Now this is giving 50%. So this is comparatively worse than this, right? So how do we quantify? So here it is very obvious that these are different temperatures you can make out. But if we have different temperature ranges or different devices, and if I want to compare which one is better than other, so for that we can define second law efficiency. So this second law efficiency gives you what is the actual efficiency that is observed or recorded for that particular device, and how much theoretically we can get using the first law. If we assume that all the processes are reversible, so what is the efficiency that we get? So for example, in the last slide, so for A, I have 40% is what is reported, while theoretically 50% should be obtained. Okay, using a reversible assumption, I can say that 50% efficiency should be there. So second law efficiency is 80%. Now for this one, we have 75% should be there if it is reversible, but actual engine has 50%. So the second law efficiency becomes 66.6%. So clearly this one is much better than this. In a similar way, we can also define second law efficiency for refrigerator and heat pump in terms of COP. So I can write that. Okay, for this is for, we can also say for engines that whatever is the useful work that has been performed, and how much work should be there for a reversible engine. Similarly, for heat pumps, I can say that what is the COP that is actually observed and what is the COP for a reversible device. If you take the ratio, similarly, you will get some efficiency, second law efficiency. Or I can also say in other in terms of exergy, I can say that whatever is the exergy recovered, okay, and whatever is the exergy that is expended. That is how we define second law efficiency. Or I can say that 1 minus whatever exergy is destroyed. So this is basically loss. Okay, you are losing some amount of exergy or work due to irreversibility. So that is what we will subtract. And what is the total amount of exergy that is expended? So how much theoretically we have and how much we have lost to irreversibility or friction or other irreversible effects. So that will give us second law efficiency. Okay. Now let us look at how do we find exergy for closed and open systems. So for closed system, we have exergy, which is defined as capital X. It is the difference of delta of internal energy, displacement work, PdV, P delta V, and exergy destruction heat loss. So T naught S. Now, this U naught, V naught, and this is basically referring to the properties with naught subscript refers to the condition when it comes to the dead state. Okay. So, initially, let us say we started with U, we started with V, P naught V, we started with T naught S. Then finally, we reach the dead state. Okay, dead state is at P naught, T naught. So then we'll say what is the difference between initial and final states. So this is how we'll represent. What is the total exergy available with the system? And dead state is also important because that is what is giving us this difference. What is the surrounding conditions that are taking into account using not subscript, U naught, V naught, and S naught are for the surrounding. Okay. Now, delta X is the change in exergy for a system, which is X2 minus X1, which will be M times. So I can write as a small x, or I can write phi. Phi, I can use a symbol for exergy. So I can write phi 2 minus phi 1. So this is the change of exergy for that particular system. And this can again be written in this form, U2 minus U1. Now I will not talk about surrounding because I'm talking about the system only. So I'm saying that the system is changing from 2 to 1. So whatever is the change in energy for that system. And for a closed system, I can write this in per unit mass basis. So in specific terms. So specific exergy for a closed system is the change is delta V, which is delta U, P naught delta V, P naught delta S. So this is the analysis for a closed system. Now let us look at open system. So for exergy for open system, I will denote by this symbol, psi. So psi is, so last slide you have seen that for a closed system, we refer this as P, and this is the difference of U, internal energy. Now for our open system, we also have flow work, right? So U plus PV, which is equal to H. H will be there, delta H, you know, delta S, plus this is the change, this is the kinetic energy term and potential energy term. So these are additional terms because we have an open system now. So similarly, exergy change for a system can be written like this, psi 2 minus psi 1. Is delta H, what is the change in enthalpy, minus T naught delta S, whatever is the change in exergy. Sorry, not exergy, entropy, plus change in kinetic energy of the system. V square is the kinetic energy term, and GZ is the potential energy term. So with that, we will analyze exergy for a open and closed system. So let us talk about Guy-Stodola theorem. So we have seen that The irreversibility can be denoted as reversible work minus useful work. Okay, this is basically W surrounding or any dissipative or irreversibility, that everything is taken into account by this factor EI, irreversibility. So I can say that irreversibility is basically, in simple terms, it is the lost work. Okay, this is what is lost. This I cannot use it for any for any useful work. So that is basically loss. Okay. So the rate of generation of irreversibility is equal to rate of generation of lost work. So this dot symbol on the top represent rate. So when you say m dot, it means that what is the rate of mass flow rate. So W lost is equal to T naught delta S of the universe, or T naught delta S of what is generated. So this is your Guy-Strodola theorem. So if you want to calculate what is the irreversibility, you can simply calculate what is the T naught into entropy generation. If you are, I would suggest you can refer to the entropy chapter to look what is S gen and what is delta S, why delta S of universe is taken into account. Okay, so by this we can conclude that if you want to have a thermodynamic efficient process, so we'll have minimum exergy loss. Okay, so this we will try to minimize W loss and minimum entropy generation. So this also will try to minimize irreversibility, and that will minimize your entropy generation. Okay, so with that, this exergy is completed. If you have any questions, we can discuss this now. Let me first stop the recording.